I was on the train the other day going to Boston, and they make this announcement, and they say, if you see something, say something. And I thought, well, that's sort of ironic, because all the people I know of who saw something and said something got in trouble. And I think we're going to hear from maybe one or two people, people who worked for the FBI, there are people who worked for the Secret Service, there are people who worked for all of these agencies who spoke up, and all kinds of things happened to them. Some of them ended up in a psych ward. Others faced various forms of retribution. Contempt and ridicule are very, very common when you're not with the conventional script, shall we say. And it's amazing to me to see how you can be marginalized for caring. And I've seen that my whole journalistic career, that people who actually took a risk because they believed in the espoused principles of this country, and then bad things happened to them. And of course, you know, as we're growing up, we're going to school, we're told about the values of this country and how it's so important to do the right thing, and then there's no follow through on that. I know many of you are here because of the 9/11 issue. I am going to be speaking about that only somewhat tangentially, but I should tell you what I will be talking about is very much directly related. And I should also tell you that I do know something about 9/11 because I was there. I live in New York City in Lower Manhattan, and I heard the planes go over my apartment. I was surprised to hear planes that loud, and I turned the television on and saw the footage of the planes hitting the building. I raced downtown, and I was reporting that day for the Los Angeles Times. The rest of the week, I wrote a number of different stories for the Telegraph, a major newspaper in the UK, the London Observer, the Frankfurter Allgemeine, and various other international publications. And I also happened to be standing there in front of a building called World Trade Center 7, speaking on the phone to my editor at the Los Angeles Times, right when the building collapsed in front of me. And I remember my shock. And I remember, I actually described this to the editor as the building was falling. And I remember just saying, oh my God, this building is pancaking neatly right in front of me. And he exclaimed, and he said, well, how can that be? That's just incredible. I said, I don't know. Anyway, so I was there. I don't have any inside information. It's a subject I'm going to talk about, and I am very, very interested in it, but I just wanted to get that out initially. One of the things that we see that happened with this issue, and I'm speaking not of particular theories or anything, I'm just talking about the whole issue itself of what happened. One of the biggest cataclysms in American and recent world history, was that the media turned away from this. And part of this was revulsion and shock and to the system, to the individual system, and then to the body politic. This was so disturbing on every possible level that it doesn't compute. And what happens with this kind of trauma is we just shut down. And you all know this. You all are here because you didn't shut down, but you all know people probably in your immediate family, your neighbors and so on, who just shut down. They don't want to hear about it. They don't want to talk about it. It is overwhelming to the senses, and it's the same thing for the media. It's not that the media is in cahoots or is bad or something like that. It's just that the media is just a whole lot of people trying to cope, trying to do their jobs, trying to keep their jobs, trying to stay focused and so on. And it was sort of, you've heard the expression too big to fail about, you know, Goldman Sachs and all these places. Well, this story was like too big to cover. And what bothers me about that as a journalist is that no serious journalist should ever out of hand, well, number one, they should never fail to cover, they should always cover at least the big stories. And somebody was telling me that, I think it was at the Washington Post, they, you remember this couple who got into that White House dinner, and apparently they had put together a team of 30 people to cover that. And this reporter pointed out to me, they said, we never had more than, you know, three people covering Iraq. Gives you a sense of the priorities. And so the big stories, our obligation is we must cover the big stories. And no serious journalist should ever, out of hand, reject any scenario as completely impossible or implausible where human nature and power are concerned. It is our job to consider the evidence and to dig in. And one of the problems, and I'm sure you know this if you've approached journalists, and I have to say I'm probably guilty of the same thing, so many people come to us with so many things, and frankly, some of them are a little bit off. And a lot of these stories are wrong if you check them out, and so you can't check everything out, so there's this kind of resistance. But there shouldn't be resistance to a story which happened. Everybody knows it happened. Everybody knows it was huge. Everybody knows this enormous number of people died. All these basic facts about it that are not in dispute. Forget about all the other things that you're discussing that there's some contention on, but just think of all the things that are not in dispute. There are so many of them that if you just look at the reporting on the things that are not in dispute, it's inadequate. It is inadequate. As I say, I'm not an expert on this. I spent the last 5 years working on Family of Secrets, and that took all of my energy. But I can see, you know, that I, as a moderately informed person on this issue, I don't understand exactly how they know who was on the planes and were they really definitely on the planes and did we really get a good, you know, sort of scientific evaluation of exactly how those buildings came down, if in fact they came down the way they say that they did. So these are all very, very interesting to me. You don't have to have a position on 9/11 to want answers. And you don't have to be a kook to wonder if the co-chairman of the 9/11 Commission, a commission that itself has no credibility, have basically claimed that they were lied to, that there might be something going on. And if you look back at the other commissions over the years, I can't even name them all because the first thing you do when anything happens and you don't want to deal with it is you create a commission. So there have been commissions for everything, right? Iraq, you know, Iran-Contra, Watergate, and so on. And if we have time to go through a few of the revelations in Family of Secrets, one of them is that somebody earlier said we need more Woodwards and Bernsteins, but as I reveal in Family of Secrets, Woodward and Bernstein were not who you thought they were, and the whole Watergate story was not what we thought it was. So any commission, by definition, and any major investigation that wins the plaudits of the establishment, you got to step back for a second and say, how good was this thing? There's a crisis of confidence in America today, and we see this on all levels, and this kind of feeds into the rise of the Glenn Becks and what have you, and the kind of hysteria. And this is because we're sort of panicked that we can't trust anything. The media, in the lowest esteem it's been in, the government, certainly the financial system, and on and on and on. And because of this, there is not only a crisis, but a tremendous opportunity. There's a tremendous opportunity for journalists to show what we can do and to regain, to win the public's trust. Unfortunately, there is tremendous pressure on journalists not to pursue certain stories. And I'm not talking about necessarily an organized effort. If it was an organized effort, it would be maybe something that we could do something about or at least identify. It's much more insidious than that. And I don't remember the exact phrasing I use in Family of Secrets. If you read it, you may know, where I talk about this kind of quiet thing that I covered totalitarian and authoritarian societies, the fall of communism and so forth. And one of the things you see is that most people kept the system, helped preserve the system, not because they were told to do it, but simply because they were afraid. And there was this sort of self-censorship. And this exists throughout all societies, and it exists, to my mind, in the most insidious form in a society like ours where we bray about how free we are. That is where you see most of that. Because if you're proud of yourself and how green your lawn is and how well you generally do investing and how cool NASCAR is and everything else, and you're telling your kids and you take them for 5 minutes to Valley Forge and then it's on to the consumerism plunge at the outlet mall, you really don't want to hear that everything ain't hunky-dory. And so there is this kind of pressure on ourselves to not talk about things that matter, and then on other people, shut up. We don't want to talk about that. An earlier speaker urged you, I thought he was very eloquent, I think it was Manny Badillo, and he said, read. And, you know, I love that because people, I do a lot of, you know, radio shows and things, and people always say to me, well, this is so depressing. What can we do? And what can we do about it? We're just, you know, one person or something. And I say, well, first of all, almost everything meaningful that happened in history was one person. Almost every cure, almost every scientific advancement, Amazon and Microsoft and you know, rockets and everything else. I mean, it basically started with one person. So every single person in this room actually holds a tremendous amount of power. You just have to be determined and figure out how to implement that. But reading is an amazing thing because here's a way that you can kind of build personal power in the comfort and privacy of your own home. And I hope to get a little bit more into that. One thing I notice is that most people simply do not have the command of the most elementary facts about our country. And if you talk to them, they get almost everything wrong. To say nothing of the fact that, you know, polls show that, you know, 40-some% of the public can't name, you know, the vice president and things like that. But, I mean, if you take the people who consider themselves better informed, they have the wrong narrative, it turns out, on almost everything. They misunderstand people who were president of the United States, maybe Reagan, let's say, for 8 years. They don't really understand what was going on or who he was. They have wrong impressions of so many different things. And I attribute this largely to the fact that they're not reading enough, or they're all, if you look at the Amazon ratings, they're all rushing out to buy, you know, Sarah Palin's memoirs or something like that. But they're not reading more challenging material, which is out there. And there are tons of great books. They come out all the time. And I've always got huge stacks around my house, and I'm in the middle of reading four or five of them because there's so much amazing work being done. And we all owe it to ourselves and to our society to be constantly reading and bugging everybody else to read. Okay, so speaking of reading, I just out of curiosity, how many of you happen to have heard of Family of Secrets? This is a book about a man who was just president of the United States, the most powerful person in the world, for 8 incredibly convulsive years. It is a book that has a shocker on every single page. New information that has never been reported before, information that I didn't know until I found it in the course of doing this research. It's so shocking, I am told, that it changes your understanding of major American events, not just during the 8 years he was president, but going back decades. And for example, if you look on the back cover, I don't remember the exact quote, it's from a man named Dan Rather, who was earning, I think, you know, $8 million a year and on top of the world, and then suddenly he was persona non grata over an issue where he was challenging or reporting on something relating to the Bush family. Dan gave me a very nice blurb for the book where he says, this changed my understanding of even events to which I was an eyewitness. And so we have, for those of you who've read it, know 4 or 5 chapters of all new material relating to the assassination of John F. Kennedy. Sounds strange for that to be in a book about the Bushes, and I'll try to explain a little bit more about that if we have time. And about Watergate, a few chapters on that, and about Richard Nixon, things that I didn't know and that we didn't know